Plus, there is the far from simple matter of two by-elections in seats that have been safe Labour for some years. As Max Cotton reports, they are looking a bit like the Prime Minister now, unsafe.
A Birmingham by-election 70s style. Back then, the Tories had a new lady leader. The Labour government was not particularly popular. The local MP, a bloke called Roy Jenkins, was off to Brussels. The name may have changed from Stechford to Hodge Hill, but the place is basically the same. And next week's election in Birmingham is a mirror of its predecessor years ago. In the 1977 version, this eager young Tory called Mackay was the victor. Andrew Mackay is still an MP, but for somewhere in Berkshire. He's Michael Howard's by-election guru, hired after the Tories' disastrous third place in Brent last year. For his first test, Mackay is back on his old stomping ground with a new by-election candidate. His job is making sure they don't come third again.
The whole house by the time this election's finished.
We've been second in this constituency at every general election since the war. We won it in the by-election in similar circumstances. The Conservatives have just taken control of the city council for the first time in 20 years. Tories in Brum are on the up at the moment. And we're working very hard to make sure that continues.
The Conservatives are taking this seriously. In July, these Tory MPs would normally be in Parliament or going to end-of-term dues.
There are two by-elections on July the 15th, one of them here in Birmingham, the other is in Leicester South. They're both being targeted by the famous Liberal Democrat by-election machine, and both of them the Tories are desperate to poll well in.
A whole coachload of Tory MPs, including a former leader, here because the last time the Tories gained a by-election was in 1982. They want to put pressure on Labour in Hodge Hill, who called the election even before their candidate was selected. This is Labour shock tactics. Microscopically short campaign, get it over with, don't allow the opposition to get established. But they only have one target here, the Lib Dems.
We're going to put the Lib Dems under scrutiny, there's no doubt about it. We think people need to know that they failed to back the Antisocial Behaviour Bill, that they opposed the Asylum and Immigration Bill, they even opposed measures to remove benefits from failed asylum seekers. These are the issues we're getting on the doorstep, and we're not going to let the Liberal Democrats get away without explaining to people why they did that.
The Tories aren't a threat for the Labour Party here in Hodge Hill, then?
They're always a threat, and we're robustly putting their message under scrutiny as well. But we're very clear that the issue on the doorstep here is crime and antisocial behaviour. The Liberals are against people on that.
So Labour don't seem that scared of the Conservatives, do they? There's always one issue that characterises a by-election, and here it's unpopular mobile phone masts. Because the Liberal Democrat candidate lobbies for companies that put them up. Conservative and Labour campaign managers stir the pot merrily. This sort of treatment is not normally aimed at the Lib Dems. Kennedy being lampooned by Labour activists is about wrong-footing the Lib Dems.
In both campaigns, Labour attacking the Liberal Democrats all the time, but then they may lose the Liberal Democrats because they cannot defend the record of their government in serving those areas, nor the invasion of Iraq, the post office closures, the council tax increases, the introduction of top-up fees and tuition fees. Yes, we can win both, but I'm saying it will be close, I think. In both seats, in Leicester South and in Birmingham Hodge Hill, only a handful of votes will separate Labour and the Liberal Democrats next Thursday, and the Conservatives will be in a poor third place in both, and they know it.
This is Leicester South, different from Birmingham Hodge Hill in that it's more ethnically diverse. And fighting for the Asian vote here has sparked the most fabulous leaflet war. Here is one of Labour's leaflets in which their candidate is described as anti-war. I'd love to hear what Tony Blair has to say about that. The Liberal Democrats go further and actually give their candidate a different name. In this leaflet, which goes to a predominantly Asian ward, he's described as Parmjit Singh Gill. Whereas in this leaflet, which goes to a mainly white ward, he's described simply as Parmjit Gill. This goes to a castle-focused team. Castle is a predominantly white ward, and the name Singh is missing.
Castle's rather more mixed, actually. But there you see, Premjit Gill, the very popular local Lib Dem campaigner, his photograph on both leaflets. Now, I ask you, you see his photograph and you see who he is on both leaflets. I think he could well be the next MP for Leicester South.
Why bother to do it?
Why bother to do what?
Why bother to have different names on it?
Well, some people I think will know that Sikh communities tend to like having a full name in. For other people, it's more like a middle name. I think it's a complete irrelevance of an issue. I think the very fact that Labour are talking about such issues shows they are desperately bothered that they may lose two by-elections next Thursday.
Back in Birmingham, the big fish who visited Hodge Hill this week all came to campaign not on schools and hospitals, but crime and disorder. It's a one-policy election where the Lib Dems and the Tories say Labour has had 20 years with an MP in this constituency to sort it out. Labour hope their hardball national law and order policies are going to wash well, and there's a former Home Secretary to make sure you're listening. And Michael Howard has a special line in dealing with drug dens and cleaning up towns. This is an odd by-election. Everyone's agreed the agenda. The fall guy is the normally squeaky clean Charles Kennedy. And none of the three main parties say they expect to win.
You won this seat, Michael, in 1977 when there was an unpopular Labour government. Is it humiliation for you if you don't win this one this time?
Of course not, but we're fighting to win. Whether Stephen wins, I very much hope he will, he would make an excellent Member of Parliament, is up to the people of Hodge Hill. They have an opportunity next week to send a clear message to Tony Blair.
The Conservative writer Joanne Nadler has a new book out this week. It's called Too Nice to Be a Tory, a title which grapples with the Tories' core problem.
The Conservatives need to do well here, don't they? But it doesn't feel like a particularly easy seat for them.
Well, it's hardly natural Conservative territory, but the party has won here before, and now more than ever, it needs to show that it can do so again, because it's trying to get new messages across on health and education, on people's everyday concerns. And if it doesn't manage to do that here, it's in trouble.
I mean, coming third, presumably, is the nightmare.
Coming third would be a nightmare. They came third in the Brent East by-election last year. That did for Ian Duncan Smith. It's vital that they show they can build on the result they had at the last general election here when they came second. To do any worse than that would be very bad for Michael Howard and show that he hasn't managed to get those new messages on the public services across.
In the 70s, the blue-collar vote in the West Midlands decided it was more interested in buying its council house and a holiday in Spain than it was in working-class solidarity. That phenomenon put Mackay into Hodge Hill and also put a Tory briefly into Leicester South in the 80s. Hodge Hill needs that feeling if the Tories are to recover. The folk who live here are about to demonstrate the terms under which the next general election is going to be fought. If the Tory vote gets squeezed out again by the Lib Dems, then there are plenty of pundits who will talk about the 2005 general election as all but over.
Max Cotton reporting. There are seven candidates standing in Birmingham, Hodge Hill and 11 in Leicester South. There are their names on your screen. There are more details on the website, and there's also more on those by-elections for viewers in the Midlands later in the programme. I'm going to be speaking with the Conservative Shadow Cabinet member Theresa May about the Tory challenge in those seats there.
Have you got election fever yet, I wonder? If you live in Leicester South or Hodge Hill, you should have. As we heard earlier on the programme, there are just 5 days to go until polling. Leicester South was held by Jim Marshall for the best part of three decades until his death in May. Like Hodge Hill, it would normally be considered a safe Labour seat. But these are anything but normal times. So let's get more now from John Hess. Afternoon, John.
Hi, Adrian. Take a look at this. That's some view, isn't it? I'm on the fourth floor of one of the tallest buildings here at Leicester University. The campus is slap bang in the heart of the Leicester South constituency. Now, if you want to really know what's going on in this campaign, you need to get over there and get your ear to the ground.
Conservatives, Labour, Liberal, they're all the same in the end of the day.
Meet a Kennedy not interested in high political office. Pat Kennedy was so angry at the closure of his kid's special school in Leicester that he decided to stand as a protest. It's what makes by-elections so fascinating.
I'm standing on the platform of Save Our Schools, As you know, they want to try and close our six special schools. We don't want them to do that, do we?
The voters of Leicester South will have the choice of 11 candidates. Areas such as this are being mass canvassed for the first time in generations. So what do the voters make of it all?
The main topic agenda is Iraq war.
I think it's local stuff. I mean, I think the war is behind us now.
How do you think you'll be voting in this by-election?
I think I'm still thinking.
This Kennedy's been in the constituency so often, you would think he was the Lib Dem candidate. That job falls to Parmjit Singh Gill, a local city councillor. So will a Lib Dem victory fall into his hands?
Iraq is important to everyone, but it's particularly important in this constituency where we have a Muslim population of 19,000. And they're very sensitive to the issue, especially with recent figures of 300% more Asians being stopped and searched by police.
We are the real Labour Party.
Shoulder to shoulder with MP George Galloway, Respect candidate Yvonne Ridley. The former Express newspaper's war reporter also hopes to benefit from an anti-Labour, anti-Iraq war backlash.
I converted to Islam just over a year ago, and that has created a great deal of interest in the community as well.
Up to a third of the population in Leicester South are from the ethnic communities. That helped to underpin Jim Marshall's 13,000 Labour majority at the last general election.
That's what happens. Liberal Democrats mean cuts.
Labour's targeting local issues and controversial spending cuts imposed by the Lib Dem-run City Council. Don't mention the war, though. Labour's keen to move on.
It is interesting the extent to which now all concerns seem to be moving on from that as events in Iraq unfold and things begin to turn to a rather more positive future there. People seem to be looking again at more domestic issues.
The Tories are determined not to be overlooked. Its candidate is Chris Heaton-Harris, a Euro MP with his eyes on Westminster.
Lots of local issues have come up, including, you know, putting a lid on recycling boxes and things. So, you know, from the smallest local issue to a big picture thing like crime, we've been talking about all those things.
And here's a list of all the candidates standing in the Leicester South by-election. There are 11 altogether. The issues may be local, but the verdict of the voters on Thursday will have national consequences.
Well, no shortage of choice for the voters of Leicester South. In fact, both Labour and the Conservatives have talked of nothing else but, excuse me, extending choice on those key issues such as health and education. And all the main parties over the last few weeks have introduced new policy initiatives of one kind or another. But will they have any direct impact on voting intentions here? Well, joining me at Leicester University, James Stanier, who's a lecturer in political communication, and Manzil Mogul from the Leicester-based Federation of Muslim Organisations. Manzil, first of all, on the war, have voters moved on from the war or not, do you think?
Not at all. It's a totally unjust and unjustifiable war against Iraq, where the Muslims very angry, and the consequent diabolical repercussions have made them angry still. They cannot forgive the government, and they are bent upon punishing the government for this act of war against Iraq.
Punishing the government, but which party is likely to benefit from that?
The Liberal Democrats were the principal beneficiaries in last year's local elections, and the same thing would have happened this time. But this time, you've got the intervention of George Galloway's Respect Party, and I think that a lot of emotional vote will go to the candidate of the Respect Party. The Liberal Democrats will pick up some Muslim votes, but not enough, perhaps, to see them through.
So that emotional vote, James, who stands to gain and who stands to lose most from this by-election?
Well, I think that's a good question. I think the government probably stands most to lose. I mean, this is, after all, a safe Labour seat. The government should be, this time, should be expecting to keep it. But the Tories also have a lot to lose. You'd expect Michael Howard and the Conservative Party at this time in the electoral cycle to be making some impact, some inroads into these are sort of seats that they need to capture.
We heard a little bit earlier Theresa May on the Politics Show saying that, in effect, this by-election was a two-horse race between Labour and the Conservatives.
Well, I'm sure the Liberal Democrats would dispute that, but I think most parties are claiming it's a two-horse race, and short of having any solid polling evidence, it's very difficult to determine who the two leading horses are.
Manzil, what's the main message that the parties are getting across? Is there evidence that perhaps there's a different message, as we heard a little bit earlier, going to the Muslim community and a totally different message going to other communities here?
Most certainly. The message to the Muslim communities revolves around Iraq, because that is most sensitive for the Muslim voters. The message outside is based on other issues, like cuts recently made by the local authority. Local authority cut a huge number of projects in Leicester. It's based on education, on health service. So there are two aspects to the campaign going on. But I feel quite strongly that the Muslim vote is crucial in the fate of this by-election. And it will continue to be so because Muslims throughout the country are angry with the government, and throughout the country they will play this role for a long, long time to come.
Which parties are likely to benefit from that Muslim vote that's there going begging?
I think what Manzar said at the respect mainly, but I think just two points if I could pick up. The first point really about targeting. I think all parties now target voters, you know, selecting specialist messages to different elements of the constituency. And I think in some senses the impact of the Muslim vote will depend on the turnout levels. And if the turnout is low, then yes, I agree. But if it's not and it's increased, and the party's managed to mobilise.
And on turnout, you actually live in the constituency yourself.
Indeed.
What difference does the intensity of the campaigning we see actually have on voters and on turnout, do you think?
Well, I think it can, you can have too much of a good thing, but I think it's great to have parties coming round, mobile, you know, knocking on doors, providing you with information, showing some interest in the constituents. I mean, usually in the general election, this was a safe Labour seat, and we are virtually ignored. So it's, you feel like you're caught up and part of the event, if you like, and maybe turnout will increase.
And Manzar, what do you think the consequences could be?
The Muslim turnout would be very substantial because they are electrified with this by-election. I can assure you of that. Now, as far as I'm concerned, it is a free horse race. The outcome is unpredictable.
Unpredictable. Let's leave it there, Mansell Mogul and James Stanley. Thank you very much. And Adrian, well, back to you.
Many thanks, John. Now to Hodge Hill, Labour's safest seat in Birmingham, but where, like Leicester South, they can take nothing for granted. Sarah Chaunder's been finding out what matters to the voters there.
Washwood Heath in Birmingham, part of the Hodge Hill constituency. It falls within the top 5% of deprived wards in the country. People here are desperate for change.
They should have cameras in this area, more police on the beat.
This place is going downhill. I mean, there's all litter all over the place.
There's too many rats and too many drug dealers on the corners.
You've got druggies up here on the corner. You've got gangs of kids roaming around with nothing to do.
Places for kids to play. Drug stops, trouble, robberies. There's nothing here for anybody. Everybody's moving.
Until now, Alstom Train Manufacturers has been one of the biggest employers here, but nearly 1,000 workers are being made redundant.
Job losses is just one of the issues concentrating the minds of voters here in Hodge Hill next week. Another is the issue of postal voting fraud.
The row over postal votes, which erupted during last month's local elections, rumbles on into this by-election. Now there's strong opposition to this method of voting at the local Elders Welfare Association.
Once they introduce the postal ballots, a lot of candidates knocking the people's door, give it to me. So who are you going, please, and who are you in this, please?
I'm totally against it as a postal vote, unless you are disabled, you are sick, or something wrong with you.
They are coming to the house, please sign me and give me the paper. This is not the right way.
You used to have to be ill or on holiday to qualify for a postal ballot, but the government relaxed the rules to get more people to vote.
It is easier to cheat the system, and by having so many ballot papers floating around the system in the post or being delivered, a number of ballot papers being delivered to any one house or location, then obviously there's opportunities for other people to use those ballot papers.
The Respect Party has made an official complaint about a letter sent out by the current MP for Hodge Hill to his constituents. It included an application for a postal vote. There's nothing technically wrong with that. But in the context of last month's elections, does the whole process need reviewing?
It seems to me to be an inherently undemocratic process. We're moving away from the situation where one voter makes up their mind on the basis of the debates that they've heard during the whole of the election campaign, goes to the ballot box at the same time as all the other voters and cast their vote for the party of their preference. And when you begin to depart from that process, you're beginning to corrode the democratic process.
The Labour candidate wasn't keen to talk about postal voting, preferring instead to focus on the real issues affecting residents.
There are issues about postal voting, but this campaign is about antisocial behaviour. That's what people want to talk about on the doorstep. Our plans are to get much tougher on antisocial behaviour and gangs of louts that cause misery for others.
So worried about fraud, Michael Howard used his visit to the constituency to call for independent election monitors.
We are in danger of getting a devaluation of the vote, with a market in votes potentially being created.
And in their campaign literature, the Liberal Democrats are warning people not to have their votes stolen.
Obviously, what we all want is more people to come out and cast their votes, but we want people to have confidence in the system and the way in which they cast their votes. So I think it's quite right that the issue should be looked into, and the evidence that's resulted from the local and the European elections is examined closely.
So this is shaping up to be a hotly contested and controversial election, with a total of seven candidates battling for what's been a safe Labour area for all but two of the last 54 years.
Sarah Chandler there, and the MP David Taylor was watching that report with me. David, postal voting rules, we've heard there, they were relaxed to encourage more people to vote. It sounds like they need to be tightened up again, doesn't it?
Not necessarily. It's important that people are given every opportunity to vote, particularly those that are housebound or have other problems. And I and others have discussed this with Sam Younger, the head of the Electoral Commission, just weeks ago. There have been allegations in the East Midlands, in particular during the European elections, we were all out postal votes, that there had been abuses of that kind. Well, there was no proof, there were no police charges, but if any party worker or any candidate oversteps the line, then there must be legal action taken and penalties pressed for of the most severe nature. I wouldn't deny that, but I don't think the problem is as bad as we're hearing today.
Briefly, in terms of the national picture, these Midlands by-elections this week are going to be crucial, aren't they? Particularly given all of the rumours there are surrounding Mr Blair's future.
It is important to the government that they hang on to two seats that have previously been safe seats. But I've visited three wards in Leicester South, the Freeman's Ward, Aylston and Ayres Monsell, and knocked on lots of doors. Only one was Iraq mentioned. It was local issues, it's antisocial behaviour, it was the performance of the local authority. That's what will determine the result.
David, thank you very much indeed. And we'll have full coverage of both by-elections in a special results programme starting at 12:30 on Thursday here on BBC One, as well as coverage on your local BBC radio station and TV news programme. Now, Jeremy.